Okay, so our first speaker will be Riley Doran, speaking about monitoring of geoengineering effects in their natural anthropogenic analogs. Riley? Please quiet down out there.
Okay, thank you. This study is funded by the Keck Institute of Space Studies. It was motivated by efforts to identify specific gaps in process understanding that represent risks to considering geoengineering either as subscale field experiments or full-scale deployment. So this is a study focused on identifying uncertainties and trying to reduce them. I just want to highlight my co-leads for this study, Alan Robach for Rutgers, Graham Stevens from JPL, and Doug McManowski from Caltech. And there's been a fairly large study team that's been involved in the form of two workshops, one we had in May of this year at Caltech, and one we just finished last month. These are week-long workshops. And I'll give you some more insight into what we covered and where we're heading with this. And the focus on this, again, is on physical process understanding of using observations, data analysis, and modeling. We're not doing technology development or field testing with this effort. Since this session is on geoengineering research policy, I wanted to start by stepping back and looking at this from a bigger picture, and that is that we shouldn't think of geoengineering in a vacuum, that in fact the coupled Earth-climate-human system to which we're seeking to respond to how changes are affecting it takes four forms. There's actions in the form of mitigation, adaptation, geoengineering, and then non-action is a response, i.e. suffering. And it's important to remember these things are also connected, that things that we do in one domain have lever arms on other domains and or they can weaken your ability to do one of these things or, as we like to say or don't like to think about, unintended consequences. And so my point is that when we talk about doing research on geoengineering, that's a very narrow view. And really what we're after here is what is the proper place for geoengineering in this broader research continuum. And also remember that the form that research takes is not just limited to Earth system science, but also engineering. And by that I mean not just the technology widget development, but things like control systems engineering and then engineering application to cutting across disciplines. Also economics, clearly, and social sciences, and that's a big bag. I just want to emphasize here that includes policy, governance, ethics, and legal considerations. All of these are poles of research programs. So when we think about geoengineering research, it's not just this box with this discipline. In a nutshell, there are four basic ways one can go about doing geoengineering research. And one can argue about the order these should be done. Starting with exploring governance, ethical, and legal implications, that in its own right is a research thrust. You can jump to focusing on development and field testing of technologies. I've shown an example here from a SPICE project that the UK government is funding, which is currently being debated. One can simulate climate responses and their consequences with using global climate models, i.e. Alan Robach's GeoMIP experiment with intercomparison. And one can study natural and anthropogenic analogs of selected geoengineering processes. The two that people are most familiar with traditionally are large volcanic eruptions, simulating stratospheric aerosol injection, and ship tracks as analogs for marine boundary layer cloud seeding. The Keck study is intentionally not addressing the two on the right because there are programs or efforts to address them, and also practically for resource limitations, we've chosen to focus on analog studies and particularly with observations and process models and leveraging GeoMIP. Additionally, again, both for practical resource limitations and because of the dimensions of other work being done and cases where we just decided we didn't want to work on it because we didn't feel it was practical, we are focused on three specific aspects of solar radiation management geoengineering. We're not addressing carbon dioxide removal, largely because there are existing well-established, relatively well-established efforts in those areas. And we didn't pick spaced parasols because we feel that that's a bit off the practical roadmap, although people can argue with you. So we focused on stratospheric aerosols, marine cloud albedo, and some perhaps surface albedo methods. What this study has led to, and by study I mean the program has two phases. We're in phase one now, which is a one-year study phase that essentially consisted of these two workshops I mentioned this year and a number of dialogues by phone and in person. And that has led to this scoping, which I'll talk about in the rest of the talk, including leading to a 2-year implementation effort, which we're going to propose for as a follow-on with the Keck Institute in April. So these are the thrusts that have emerged from this 1-year study phase, and the foci are looking at volcanic eruptions as analogs for stratospheric sulfate, ship tracks and other emissions as analogs for cloud albedo geoengineering. The third one is specifically focused on monitoring and observational methods, in this case looking at techniques for monitoring spectral albedo on space-time scales relevant to managing cloud albedo to assess whether geoengineering efforts are actually working, as distinct from closing the global energy budget. And four is a new one for us at least, and that is analysis based on targeted intervention scenarios. And by that I mean rather than the traditional trying to geoengineer the entire climate or global scenarios, we're looking at addressing specific impacts. And does that drive you to study things, or does it drive you to address processes in different ways that you wouldn't if you went at it from a global scale? And I'll give you an example of one of those scenarios, a tipping point event. So I have one slide on each of these just to give you a sense of the work that's gone into it. And there's a lot of backup material on our website, which I'll provide the link to at the end, where you can drill into this. But the volcanic eruptions as analogs for stratospheric sulfates, the key uncertainties that have been highlighted before but we intend to focus on are the impacts on cirrus clouds, including subvisible cirrus, from doing this as geoengineering and or by volcanoes. Of course, the impacts on ozone is a concern, and more work is required there. Impacts on stratospheric water vapor, what actually happens with water vapor as a result of geoengineering, and then also the impacts on tropospheric chemistry due to the fallout and evolution of these particles, not just worrying about ozone in the stratosphere. And also important here is attribution of different factors, in other words, ash, because if what we're trying to do is treat volcanoes as representative geoengineering, if we're trying to assess their efficacy and the impacts, we have to be able to deconvolve the effects of things that aren't present necessarily with geoengineering, but they're there with the natural analog. And so this is an attribution problem. And again, it comes back to the question of representativeness. In each of these areas, I'm going to talk about the implications on observational strategies, because we are taking a heavy look at just going beyond models with this. So one of the things that come out of the study is that perhaps there's more optimal use of existing satellite remote sensing data, i.e. The Calypso LIDAR mission and the OSIRIS LIM sounder, for going back and looking at some of the events that we have or have access to. Also looking at strategies for rapid response to massive eruptions to capture both the evolution in the peak of the aerosol size distribution and its evolution on the time scales of a few months. So here in this one example by Jason English, he's showing the peak happening within about 3 months to 6 months, and this rapid change phase only happening a month or two after the eruption. So this implies having a rapid response in terms of instrument capabilities, both from surface and air. The second thrust is on ship tracks and low clouds, and I should say ship tracks and other emissions because of what's come out of this assessment. Here, the key uncertainty is the aerosol albedo relationship in the closed cell regimes, and we say that's most relevant because that's where most of the clouds are, or most of the potential for significantly changing albedo are. And this is a very interesting paper that Graham Stevens talked about at the Monday session on ship tracks, showing where you have open cells, where there aren't clouds or open cells, you can see a definite impact or changes in deepening and albedo associated with the ship tracks, but maybe not so much evidence of it. In fact, it's hard to find in closed cell regimes. And there are several reasons why that says several things. One, about whether the ship tracks are really representative of where this will work. And the other issue is what's going on with other emissions. Right, so it's not sufficient probably just to study ship track emissions, but looking at other effects of anthropogenic activity that are affecting this dynamic. And so, for example, maybe extending some of the studies which have looked at effects from smelters and other emissions on aerosol albedo. Towards observational strategies, we did some work looking at some of the existing data sets and campaigns that have been done, like MACE, EPEACE, VOCALS. And to what extent different parameters of interest are covered in the observational suites that are available. If we were to go back and mine the data, what's available? And two things kind of hop out of that assessment. One is entrainment rate is generally not available in most of these studies, nor is necessarily cloud thickness. right, and also albedo. And so looking at closing observational gaps, such as entrainment and albedo, in future studies is one of the foci we'll be looking at. Specific to albedo monitoring, Graham Stevens is leading a team, a sub-team, looking at the question of key uncertainties in solar, reflected solar energy, again on space-time scales that are relevant to assessing geoengineering. Here, again, it's necessary but not sufficient to get a sense for the net impact globally, but if one is trying to go out and steer things with ship tracks and generate clouds on small scales, including the evolution of these things, it may drive you to provide spectrally resolved albedo measurements on smaller space time scales than might be available with the planned climate observations we're talking about. So it's too early for us to say that the Clario HISPRI need to be tweaked, or maybe they're necessary but not sufficient, and or are there common elements where you could combine planned observations to tease this out. The point is to come up with a strategy to provide that kind of information with either planned observations, and if they're not sufficient, then let's talk about how we would fill those gaps with future observing systems. And then the last focus area is on targeted interventions, and again, this is a phrase that generates a lot of discussion and debate, and that's probably telling you something important. This topic has been called variously targeted interventions, regional geoengineering, sectoral geoengineering, and extreme adaptation. And our point is that rather than trying to go after the whole climate problem, it is trying to hold off or band-aid or tourniquet specific perceived emergencies or impacts while making sure you don't put the tourniquet around your neck. And in this case, one of the examples we looked at was the field of Arctic tipping points. And after kicking around ideas like sea ice and ice sheets, one of the ideas that we thought we might give some focus on is the permafrost tipping point scenario. If you don't follow this, there's a significant amount of carbon pool stored in the in permafrost regions up north. This is about 19 million square kilometers, 1,700 gigatons of carbon. That's over twice the current atmospheric load. How much of this is vulnerable to release, and what form it will release in, whether it's methane or CO2, and what the mix is, and of course with methane's much higher forcing, particularly on shorter time horizons, these things could represent a serious emergency, climate emergency. So one of the questions that come out of this study is, what's the definition of a tipping point? Is it simply, quote unquote, the transition from a net source, a net sink to a net source, which argue is already underway, or is it the so-called threshold of irreversibility where one triggers the deep and sustained decomposition through microbial activity that releases methane in a way that we can't turn off or it won't extinguish, quote unquote, for 100 years or so. So this is an area where we'd like to couple with the work already being done in understanding carbon Arctic reservoirs of and their vulnerability, but apply the question of, if you were trying to mitigate or intervene in those scenarios, what parameters would you control to in terms of the forcing? What could you monitor? What could you study? And what are the local and global impacts of doing some of these things? You can imagine there's a range of ways to go at mitigating this, including how you might leverage what I would call the more traditional SRM techniques. And it has implications on observational strategies, chiefly early warning systems, if such a thing is possible. So I'll close by just summarizing that we're doing a systematic study of four topical areas, again focused on data analysis, modeling, and observations. And I just want to make the point that a truly integrated climate research portfolio, which is that first block diagram I put up, should include appropriate geoengineering studies. And of course, there's the rub. What's the definition of appropriate in terms of levels of effort and the constraints you put on the programs? That doesn't exist yet, but we should look at it also in the form of potential co-benefits. And the last point is, and we're an example of this with the Keck Foundation, absent federal direction and governance, ad hoc efforts like our own are likely to continue. And to the extent that we can coordinate and or moderate these efforts, that's a grassroots effort at this point. If you want to follow up on this, here's our website, and we'll be posting material as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have some time for a few questions.
Yes?
Mm-hmm. So the question was, give me an example of what you might do in terms of regional responses, for example, the Arctic permafrost case. For the permafrost, the carbon cycle people we talked to, you know, the obvious one is that immediately jumps out at you is affecting the surface albedo of just those regions. So plant the right kind of moss over the permafrost to provide insulation in the right times of the year and reflection in the right times of the year. That's been part of the vernacular in geoengineering for surface treatments. It's massive, but that's one option. The other one we've talked about, which is more focused on some of the ice, was looking at, and I didn't give this example, but in the case of looking at slowing down ice sheet collapse or sea ice rapid release, we're looking at either the idea of icebreakers to control the freeze-thaw rates, or how much insulation is there, or even looking and putting in a dam's not a good word, but blocks and fjords to prevent rapid outflow at ice sheets. Since a lot of the release of ice sheets is dynamic. Once you get the stuff moving, you lose a lot of ice. So those are examples of local scale or relatively regional scale efforts that could be applied. The other one is simply to focus the global SRM techniques like stratospheric aerosol injection or marine boundary layer cloud layers, but optimize for cooling the Arctic as opposed to cooling everywhere.
Okay, is there another question? In that case, I think we'll move on to the next talk, which has been given by, is it? Robert Wood. Take me just a second here.
Thank you.
That's this one, right? Oh, you're on the Mac. I'm sorry. I mean, you're not on the Mac.
I'm
you're
on the PC. PC. Yeah, sorry.
No. It's a better
place to be. Don't tell anybody.
Okay, so you can use these controls.
Great. Thank you. I'm going to talk about a very specific proposal or a suggestion, a sort of a hypothesis, a straw man, if you like, for a specific field test to test this marine cloud brightening idea. And I think this is important for a number of reasons, one of which we do want to understand how effective some of these geoengineering schemes might be. It also gets into questions that of how aerosols affect clouds from inadvertent modification to the climate, which is taking place, the aerosol indirect effects. So I think we can combine research that will give us some clues about geoengineering, also with research that will give us extremely useful control experiments to look at the effects of aerosols on clouds. And this was a work that's sort of being done in a sort of a unfunded research that's been done with quite a large group. Hugh Coe, Alan Gaddian, and John Latham from the University of Manchester. But there's a larger group of us have been talking about this, including people like Phil Rash and Chris Brotherton. This is an idea put forward in 1990 by John Latham. I won't go into the details because there's plenty of stuff out there on that. Essentially, the idea here, as Riley has said quite nicely, is that you put aerosols into clouds, you make the droplets smaller, the clouds in principle become more reflective and therefore reflect some of the radiation back to space. So if we do this by advertent modification, we can potentially offset some of the global warming. And we know this is probably important because our pollution efforts are doing this very thing, putting out sulfate in particular, but also organics and other species are thought to be offsetting some fraction, very highly uncertain, but a significant fraction of the forcing due to greenhouse gases. Why can't we just back of the envelope calculate how effective this could be? Well, the problem is that clouds are kind of complicated beasts. Clouds involve interactions between turbulence, entrainment, and cloud thickness, for example. You have to thicken the clouds. So if you change the cloud droplet concentration by inducing more aerosols, it can affect other things. It doesn't just brighten the clouds. It also changes their effectiveness at precipitating and gets into this really quite complex set of physical processes that are really quite poorly understood and which we would have to understand if we're going to understand how effective marine brightening is going to be. Why can't we just do this with models? Because models, while they are extremely useful and absolutely essential to the problem, they have their own deficiencies. This is a comparison of different process models where, with exactly the same forcings, and this is sort of the gray is indicating the model spread over a four-hour period, where all these models are trying to simulate the same cloud system, and there are problems with those models. So it's not as if the models are really sufficient at this point, and that's probably why we can't do the climate change problem either all that effectively. This is an example, though, of the usefulness of these models. This is three types of geoengineering forcing by in putting salt particles into a model. This model is 60 by 120 kilometers. And you can see if you uniformly seed the clouds versus if you send three ships, these are the particles concentrations on the bottom. These are the effects on the reflectance of the clouds on the top. And you can see quite complicated responses. You can brighten the clouds in the center, but around the edges, they get darker. So there's how we configure these this seeding is really uncertain. We don't know what would happen if we send ships out over the ocean and actually do this geoengineering. So there's a lot of unanswered questions. I think the main point I want to hammer home here, though, is that a field experiment could potentially provide really important information for understanding aerosol indirect effects, one of the largest sources of uncertainty in future climate warming. We really need to know, an experiment would have to address a series of increasingly complicated and more sophisticated questions. First of all, we need to be able to create and inject particles, and there were a couple of posters earlier this week talking about progress that's been made on creating salt particles. Then we have to disperse the particles, we have to understand the microphysical responses of the clouds, how did the cloud droplet concentrations change. We then have to understand the dynamical and macrophysical responses to those clouds. Riley showed nicely that clouds do not respond always in the same way, and so part of that is understanding how the cloud dynamics changes. And eventually we have to understand whether they actually brighten the clouds, and these are not trivial things to do. It would be a two-phased approach we would advocate. First of all, we'd have to understand injection methodologies, particle injection methodology, and how they disperse in the boundary layer. And there's issues here because if you create particles and they're negatively buoyant, they would sink and not rise into the cloud. So there's a lot of questions here about how you make particles of the appropriate size. I'm not going to get into the details of that. And then you would want to understand cloud responses in an individual ship track, and that's one of the things that Riley's suggesting that could be done, is looking at these inadvertent salt tracks, as we call them, ship tracks, but we would want to actually create those. And then also look over a limited area. So we might think about having a single ship producing particles or a variety of ships. I would argue that we would need a variety of ships to create a sort of a more uniform plume, because that's what we'd have to do in terms of geoengineering. If you look at kind of the how much radiative effect would you have to, how much sunlight would you have to reflect back to space from geoengineering, if you're going to offset doubled CO2, it's a significant amount. These are some significant tens of watts per meter squared of radiation. But that equates to essentially brightening the clouds by a factor of two in these regions. This cannot be done with the occasional ship moving through a region. It's going to have to be a systematic, very quite large scale if you want to deploy this. And so the real seeding of clouds is going to look more like this than a single ship track or the occasional ship track. And then what you would really need to do is monitor that with planes that are monitoring both the aerosols, the clouds, entrainment, these key processes that are limiting or that are modulating the strength of the radiation. And then you would have to measure the radiation. So there's a lot of measurements that would have to be done. But these experiments are done all the time, I would say. Every few years we go and make a large field experiment in the marine region of marine clouds, and recent one was vocals, and that these costs, the costs of these are not unfeasible. I mean, these are doable experiments, even with relatively today's technology or available technologies. The spraying is another issue, but I'm not going to talk any more about that. Considerations, well, I've kind of gotten into those. We would probably want to deploy these in regions of marine stratocumulus where we know that the effects are most likely to be the most significant. And then we'd have to think about, the community needs to think about the duration of such an experiment. How much would we want to do? How are we going to get statistical reliability? There's no point spending $30 million on an experiment, coming away and saying, well, maybe it worked, maybe it didn't. And this was a real problem for cloud seeding in the past for generating precipitation. The statistical reliability was really, really a troubling problem, and we really need to give that some thought. Will such an experiment induce a climate response? Of course, we're not trying to get a climate response. We're trying to get a top of atmosphere radiation response. We're not trying to change the climate with such an experiment. What we're trying to do is see how effective the brightening would be, could be in a certain regime. So we would have to make sure that as a community that we do not cause like significant climate responses. I would argue we've done some simple calculations that could show that, you know, if we did this over a couple of month period on and off with the seeding strategy, you're not likely to generate temperature responses of the upper ocean that are anything. You'd likely to create changes that are comparable to the natural variability due to ocean eddies, for example, fluxing cold water offshore. So it's unlikely that an experiment would have a climate response, but this is something the community, if we chose to do such an experiment, would have to address, and this is going back to Granger Morgan's allowable zones. We would have to make sure that the various ecosystem impacts, changes in the local sea surface temperature, did not have a climate response themselves. And so the risk assessment here is an important part of the problem. I don't need to get into that, but there's also an ethical issue here. I mean, is this an experiment? What happens if the experiment's successful or if the experiment fails? Is it going to change our thinking on geoengineering, and do we want to go down that road? We want to follow a sound science, but we also want to follow governance, sound governance, and we want to do the research that's independent. We need independent observers. We need to make sure it's objective. And these are all the things that didn't, in the end, really cause problems with cloud seeding in the past, cloud seeding for precipitation enhancement. These things all kind of fell apart and went wrong. So we need to be careful about that. We are at the University of Washington, we're involved in trying to put together a special issue of climatic change dealing with research, geoengineering research and the limits of the research and what we should do as a community. So that's an ongoing part of our discussions. And of course, public perceptions, how will the public view such an experiment if it was done? And the SPICE is an example. The SPICE was the balloon that's not being done or being done in the UK as a sort of a trial experiment, and the public perceptions is an important part of this problem. So needed, if we wanted to do such an experiment, and I would argue it could be done, the technology is needs upscaling. Sprayers that are working okay in the laboratory would need to be upscaled to make them spraying in the environment a significant amount of particles. We need to think a lot with any field experiment, but particularly with this experiment, we need to make sure that we can come up with refutable hypotheses, model assessments. This all needs to be done, and these things don't necessarily come cheap and happen naturally, so there would need to be investment slowly increasing over time. And then we have to think about the governance issues with any experiments that are involving geoengineering or thinking about geoengineering. How do we conduct independent assessment, blue team, red team kind of questions? Anyway, I'm going to leave it there, but this is just the slide again showing the potential configuration we might think about doing. These are the various people that have been collaborating on a paper that's sort of summarizing a lot of the state of our understanding of marine cloud brightening that's just been accepted for the philosophical transactions of the Royal Society. So thanks for your attention.
So we have time for some questions.
So Kelly asked about what are the potential co-benefits of such an experiment. Well, one of the problems for understanding climate change, the aerosol cloud problem is a really thorny problem. You saw the error bars. I didn't have enough time to dwell on it, but the uncertainties in our understanding of the Toomey effect, just from sulfur, mainly sulfate aerosols, in the inadvertent is huge, right? It's a factor of three uncertainty, if you like. And having a control experiment, one of the problems is when we see changes in clouds that are correlated with aerosols, do we really know that the changes are due to the aerosols, or is it some other correlation with a meteorological variable? So understanding, having a control experiment is one of those things in our field that is very hard to find, to do a control experiment where it's directly testing some physics that we know is pretty poorly handled in our climate models. So it's the co-benefits are quite strong for better understanding and then model improvement for climate models that of the aerosol indirect effects.
I'm going to take my prerogative and throw in a question as a follow-up question before we go to the other questions. That if you were just given resources to do cloud science and you didn't have the geoengineering as a driver, would you be doing something very different? Or is this really focused on geoengineering per se?
You know, no, I think that could start to get, that could get, you know, I could put a personal view on that, which is, you know, geoengineering kind of scares me, and I feel that climate change is pretty scary. So I'm partly in this because I think it's a great cloud experiment that we would learn a huge amount of information about aerosol indirect effects. So on that note, I would say yes, we could do this without the geoengineering motivation, but also I appreciate that we may be able to do this single experiment and pretty much rule out this is a method for geoengineering. I'm not saying we could, but we may do. So it's an experiment that actually has a lot of potential for understanding geoengineering. So I would say it's kind of a yes and yes. I don't know whether that was... I kind of agree.
And I think our new AGU fellow, Alan Robach, has a question.
Salt is good because I mean it's any kind of, you know, inorganic salt is of high solubility would probably be useful, but salts, you know, you could use other things. I mean and I agree that we could do this with existing ship tracks. I mean there already was an experiment done and I didn't really do justice to it in 94 to look at ship tracks with the same kind of capability. So even if we went out and did that kind of experiment with a the key is here to have the coincident planes and, you know, good, really, really good sampling. That would be useful as well. But the salt, I think, it's because you can probably make the particles relatively easily. I mean, I don't know the deal. I mean, I'm not a chemist, so I don't... I think you could do it with other things, certainly. But salt is something that people have looked at. And, yeah, the people have argued, well, it's from the sea, so it's easy to get on the ship.
I think there was Greg.
Has it been shown that the carbon footprint doing these kinds of experiments and the impacts on that carbon footprint are small relative to the benefits of the output?
Yeah, I mean, if you look
at the question.
Oh yeah. So the question was whether the carbon footprint of actually are you talking about the deployment of? So the question was whether the carbon footprint of actually going out and creating all these particles over the globe and getting the offset, whether that's actually generating more CO2 presumably than the effect it's offsetting. I think if you believe some of the numbers that are around, I would say 10,000 ships may be what's necessary to do this. This is just numbers that have been thrown out there. 10,000 ships, I think each ship, I think you could practically put like a nuclear power station on each ship if it works. And it would still, you know, that kind of coal-fired power station on each ship, and it's still offset. It's remarkable. What's beautiful about this method, in principle, is just how effective it is for very, very little mass input into the clouds. How much efficiency you could potentially get if you do the calculations. It's really quite amazing. That's not really an issue.
It's 2,000 ships.
Yeah, but that's a number from... Maybe I wouldn't trust that number so much, but...
Okay, one last question, and then we'll move on.
I'm going to take that question one further, and if you were to translate the benefit of doing this into a cost, and then a cost per ton of CO2 avoided, how many numbers are you coming up with?
Yeah, the question is whether... Are you talking about the deployment or the research for the deployment?
The deployment.
The deployment. Whether this is cost-effective in terms of how much greenhouse gas mitigation you could get for the dollar. I don't know whether I can put money. I mean, I don't know whether money is to sort of makes. I mean, what I mean if climate change is creating huge, you know, droughts and I don't know whether money is something. I mean, if you can offset greenhouse gases for relative, but putting, I think you could. This is could be potentially very cheap. I just have my doubts about how effective it really is, because I'm not sure how effectively you can brighten the clouds. So I'm not very good at answering that question. I haven't thought about it long enough, but I'll think about it some more. Thanks.
All right. Thank you very much. So the next talk will be by Margaret Leinen, representing a group that met
right.
in California earlier.
Where's the?
Oh yeah. Here's a pointer.
Okay.
And then, so that's a pointer. And then
you just did that. First. Okay. So this, I'm going to tell you about the results of a workshop sponsored by the International Geosphere Biosphere Project. To discuss ecological impacts of geoengineering. And the workshop report was, we just received word a couple days ago that it was accepted as a peer-reviewed publication by AMBIO, so you'll be able to find it there soon. And if you want it before then, you can talk to Lynn Russell, who was the chair of a large group of people who were participants in the workshop and participants in generating the workshop report. The rationale for the workshop was really to bring the ecological community, the biological community, into this discussion. So we've had a growing discussion of a wide range of different techniques that could be used to geoengineer. There are ideas for research, like the ones that we've been talking about today, published papers on research, most of which have focused on the research of the technology itself, research to determine whether it works as opposed to what its impacts might be. And there's some preliminary modeling in support of the research, but little discussion of the research needed to understand the ecological consequences. So this was really the focus of the workshop, was the first one that really brought the ecologists together on this topic. And so the results are fairly preliminary, but I think that this will give you a flavor of the way that community would come to this discussion. So we thought that there were two important questions that we should design research to answer from the ecological perspective. How would geoengineering methods influence the many roles of ecosystems in the Earth system? And would the impacts of geoengineering methods be more or less acceptable than the ecosystem impacts of the climate change that's likely under any potentially politically acceptable scenarios of emissions reduction or even unabated emissions reduction? So the perspective was not, let's look at ecosystems as they are now with our climate as it is now and then try to compare it to the impact of the various techniques that have been discussed, because the assumption is that they're probably not going to be deployed for 20, 30, name your number of decades, and by then we'll have had quite a bit of emissions. So there are two components of the report. One was consideration of the ecological impacts of various geoengineering approaches based on a set of assumptions about how the approaches work and what we think we know about ecological response, and then identification of some important considerations to think about in planning research. So we looked at five categories of techniques. SRM over the ocean, cloud albedo enhancement, a stratospheric aerosol approach, carbon dioxide removal in the ocean via ocean fertilization and on land versus via afforestation. And then at the request of a couple of the members of the workshop, we also looked at engineered carbon capture with underground storage. The assumptions were that the techniques worked approximately as the physical science community is telling us that they might, in terms of climate impact, in terms of temporal and spatial scales of effect given the deployment, and also potential side effects that we're already talking about. For example, CDR-mediated reductions in CO2 and decreased CO2 fertilization for terrestrial plants. So in order to compare impacts to a scenario that would be a non-geoengineered scenario, we had to assume a scenario for CO2 for the future, so we assumed a mid-range mitigation scenario with an approximate doubling of CO2 over pre-industrial, and given a sort of an average range of climate sensitivity, that would equate to an increase of about 3 degrees C. So each of the techniques that we looked at was compared to that non-geoengineered future as opposed to some current conditions. We, for each one of these, we examined the ecological impacts of changes from the physical climate system. So if there are temperature changes that are caused by this technique, how do those reverberate into ecosystems? Ecosystem cycling and the chemical environment, ecosystem components themselves, like productivity, biomass, et cetera, and ecosystem services. So that generated, a very substantial amount of information, which is most of the workshop report, and it's really beyond the time available to sort of go through all of that. And in most cases, of course, there's insufficient data to draw firm conclusions about the ecological impacts. But I'll give you just a flavor of the way that the ecological community approached this, using afforestation as an example. So likely changes in local and regional energy balance and hydrology, soil chemistry, acidity, and so forth. So that would then be looked at in terms of its potential effect on biomass, its effect on biomes and their distribution, its effect on ecological services. Increased demand for fertilizer and nutrients as a result of afforestation. And we would look at that compared to other nutrient demands. New forests emit volatile organic compounds, which increase cloud condensation nuclei, also increased N2O emissions. What do those look like compared to a non-geoengineered future? Surface albedo impacts, regional precipitation, and so forth. So in each case, we tried to take apart some of the ideas that have already been talked about in the literature and then look specifically at the impacts on ecosystems. One of the really large topics of discussion at the workshop revolved around these three additional concerns for the SRM techniques. One is that a high CO2 but low or moderate temperature world is a novel environment. It's not one that we've seen in the geologic past. And so its potential for changes to ecosystems is a really difficult one to look at based on what we already know or even experiments that we might do. And then SRM does not address ocean acidification, a very important ecosystem concern in the community, and the termination effect for SRM if it's terminated before CO2 is lowered. So a few comments on research strategy. If we're going to do experiments like the ones that Rob described, spend $30 million to go out and understand whether the technique works, we're not going to be able to reproduce that experiment exactly the next time that we go out and try it. So combining ecological study with these studies to look at the physical effects and the feasibility is a really important concern from the standpoint of the ecological community. So we have to combine research on ecological impacts with the perturbation experiments. That implies close coordination between the design of the experiment and the research, and may have implications for the location and duration of perturbations. A very important issue is the pre-perturbation baseline. You know, it's tough enough for us to look at that from a physical point of view, but the ecological baseline is going to be something that will be very challenging. And many of these techniques perturb multiple environments and require multiple ecological approaches as well. So some of the challenges, I already talked about the difficulty of defining the baseline because of the need for large-scale or long-term data. A need for definition of key processes and scales and variables to model. So as we start to model the real experiments or analog experiments, how do we make the linkages between the physical variables that we're much more comfortable with and the way that they reverberate into ecological impacts? That's not something that we have a lot of facility with, and that in itself needs to be a focus of the research as well. Detection and attribution questions. Riley referred to this, as did Rob, and being able to look at those with will be very challenging and may be very contentious. And I'll just finish up with a comment on analog experiments or laboratory experiments. While idealized, these can be really important in terms of directing the sorts of hypotheses that we want to look at when we come to field experimentation. And they're also the only way to look at several of the no analog or unnatural world situations. So this is a little bit of a view of how another community looks at this whole space of geoengineering, and I think that you'll hear more discussion and have more of the ecological community start to reach out to try to intersect for the design of experiments.
Great, thank you. Mike McCracken?
No, it was. The question was, you know, what exactly did we mean by that scenario? The scenario was just an emissions scenario. You know, if we're going to compare the geoengineering to something that. Or the impact of the geoengineering to something that is a non-geoengineered future, what do we choose? So this was just a scenario for a doubled CO2. We assumed that with climate sensitivity, that compared to a 3-degree temperature change. And then the group looked at what are the ecological changes that we would see as a result of that, and then what would that be like compared to either drawing down that CO2 or offsetting that temperature.
But how far? All the way to zero? To zero effect? So it's 1 times CO2 versus 2 times CO2?
Yes.
Trying to repeat what you said.
Yes.
They want it for the
night. Yeah. So we didn't model it. It was really a thought experiment in terms of what kinds of effects would you see if you were to geoengineer to eliminate that level of effect. So if you drew down CO2 to the present as opposed to, you know, the 560, or if you if you moderated average temperature down from 3 degrees to what it is now.
So it wasn't trying to just keep the climate as it is?
No.
Right.
Other questions? It's a question back there.
It's about deep sea ecosystems. What about ecosystems? We know very little of that.
Okay. Well, I couldn't hear very well. Was that what about ecosystems we don't know very much about? Okay. Yes. This was really, you know, this is the first time that anybody looked at it. So they really focused on, for the deep ocean, issues of how would the productivity effects of ocean fertilization translate to fluxes, effects on mid and bottom water, oxygen demand, and so forth. This was not a group that could go into, you know, what is the effect on holothurians of these kinds of experiments. It's really to sort of set the stage to say, here's the way that the ecological community is going to want to take a look at this.
All right, thank you very much. So in case you're getting worried about the clock, because we're letting people go a little bit long, there was a little mix-up in the schedule, so sort of we've been letting speakers go over a minute or two to compensate for that. So the next talk is by David Vinnikoff, who is presenting work that he did with Jane Long, and I guess associated with the whole various activities.
Various activities. Can you turn that blank? Because I don't have slides.
I know, I just have
your time. Okay, great. I don't have slides, so don't worry that the things aren't changing. Great, thank you. It's great to be here. I've never been to the AGU before. It's like wandering into a huge tribe, huge crazy tribe, but I'm enjoying it. It was disconcerting that there was such a big conference booklet and then a manual for the conference booklet. I was a little confused by that. It is a pleasure to be here. I would like to acknowledge my collaborator, Jane Long, who's been a great interlocutor for this work. The title, as you see, is The Governance of Solar Radiation Management Research, The Need for Innovative Institutions. So today I want to elaborate on a governance proposal for SRM research that was made in a recent report issued by the Bipartisan Policy Task Force in October. Jane and I both were members, as was Ken, and I don't know if anyone else in the room was part of it. But many groups agree that there's an urgent need for governance. We've already seen it on a bunch of slides today. We have the SRMGI, we have the Asilomar Conference. But the question is, what the heck do we do about it? What is governance anyway? And what does it mean? Is it ethics? Is it politics? So we started to try to put out proposals for what it might mean. But one of the problems is, I think, in looking at what we did and how it's discussed, is it's not clear what the purpose of governance is. Is it to contain risks of various kinds, or is it something else? For the BPC group, it wasn't just about containing physical risks, at least as I understand it, whether they were risks on the environment or of rogue actors or something like that. One of the features of the governance proposed by BPC was a new advisory committee, a new kind of committee that would develop a national framework for overseeing research. So here are the main features of that. It would be publicly constituted and would propose an oversight system for research. In particular, it would help society develop a governance framework through a visible and accountable process. So develop a framework itself and to promote societal dialogue about SRM techniques, ethical issues, and the ultimate goals of research. So again, a process was key. So developing such a committee would be an interesting institutional innovation, and it's worth thinking about, but we still don't have really a clear vision. And so what I want to do with the talk is to explore in more detail what that might look like. And I'll do it by telling a little story that may help us. And that's the story of how we came to govern genetic engineering. So genetic engineering, I think, is a very interesting analogy. So why genetic engineering as an analogy? The technologies aren't close, the scales are dramatically different. Well, in both situations, at issue is both the safety of research and also the potential implications of uses, particular dangerous, different, scary kinds of uses of that research. With GE, it was actually engineering life forms and maybe even engineering humans. So many receive or remember the rDNA governance story as a story of self-governance. And it was interesting that the Asilomar conference took place there in part, I think, to invoke Paul Berg, and that was done on purpose. And I think it was done out of an idea that we first need to get together and generate self-governing norms. But the self-governance aspect was only one part of the rDNA governance story. It was the very beginning of that story. The community of microbiologists did come together to write in favor of a moratorium in science. They met at Asilomar and they proposed a three-tier risk approach to recombinant DNA experiments. But the actual system of governance was actually developed through a government agency, ultimately, the NIH. The agency head, Caspar Weinberger, was informed and received advice from Paul Berg and created the Recombinant DNA Advisory Committee, the RAC, which is known as the RAC. And this is an important body, I think, when we think about governance for geoengineering. But this body was brought together to create an assessment framework that would emerge from a process of rulemaking deliberation. And then it would actually assess and oversee particular research proposals. Now this would take place, development of the assessment framework, within a public process that's associated with administrative rulemaking under many administrative agencies. As a lawyer, I kind of like talking about that. So what's interesting about this is that over time, this assessment framework changed. It modified it. It was adapted as scientific understanding increased, as society got more comfortable with these research experiments going on. And gradually, the level of scrutiny was reduced. And there was kind of an accommodation with doing this kind of research. So you might ask, though, why did we get Frankenfoods? So that's the part two of the story. And I would argue that the Frankenfood frame really came out of Europe initially. It emerged in the wake of the mad cow crisis, where there was an extreme loss of trust in regulators of food safety and other kinds of health safety. Then that was seized upon by Greenpeace, plus anti-globalization NGOs. And so they seized upon GMOs as a very good focus for activism around nature and around anti-globalization. But arguably, this was allowed, this took root, because there wasn't the same kind of public process that there was, this is my hypothesis, in Europe as there had been in the late 70s in the United States. So I would actually say that part of the reason that there's a different response to GMOs is precisely because of the kinds of procedures that went on in the US in late 70s and into the early 80s. The process, as painful as it was, this was an important process. Let me extract two key points here, and then see if we can apply that to the geoengineering context. The two key points are that first, if bodies like the RAC are going to be effective, they shouldn't aim to be technical advice bodies. They are quasi-political bodies that provide advice with technical and value-based content. And that's clear, that's important because it has implications about who should sit on these bodies, And also, what kinds of participants, stakeholders, should be participating. The second point is about public process. The key aspect here is structuring a engaged process to generate acceptable frameworks for assessment. They made a space for discussion of underlying values and goals. Inviting the more people in is not just creating a huge town hall meeting in, you know, downtown Berkeley or something. There are ways to structure engagement with broader communities that isn't just having a massive, huge town hall meeting. And there are analogies and useful mechanisms in administrative law and other places. Okay, moving to the how this might help us refine the BPC proposal. So what we're proposing, and this is slightly different to the BPC proposal, with apologies to my co-members, is that we need to bring into being a national commission for the study of climate change choices. Not on geoengineering, which I'll say a little bit more later about. That it should have experts broadly defined to include modelers, engineers, risk assessment experts, international and regulatory lawyers, ethicists. But they'll also need more political credibility, so it should also have public intellectuals, so people like David Brooks or maybe a head of a university or something like that. One good model is the current Obama's Presidential Commission on Bioethical Issues. So that has a nice mix of different expertises, and its president is Amy Gutman, who is the president of University of Pennsylvania, and she's also a professor of scholar, one of the foremost scholars in political science in deliberative democracy. So she's who was put forward as heading up this committee. The first task they should do is to set up this architecture of assessment. It's these tiers of risk for research experiments. I don't agree with the Granger model, which is you have to technically define a allowed zone so research can first get started. I think that has to be part of the political negotiation and process. I think that could probably be handled pretty soon, but it would lend a new kind of legitimacy to the research that does start. I don't know what my time is like, but there are a few controversial, I guess, assertions I would put out there for discussion. One is, I already mentioned the allowed zone. I bet there are disagreements with that. But another is, who defines, this has come up with Ken, who defines what a geoengineering experiment is, or how do we know what kinds of experiments might even be subject to this kind of regime? What falls out, and how do we tell? What if an experiment looks on its face like it can be useful for generalized knowledge about atmospheres and oceans? How would you know exactly? So I think that's something that we'd have to grapple with. My assertion would be you could probably tell. The experiment that was put up before on clouds, it's clear that the intent was that this would be useful for potential deployment of aerosols, or not aerosols, of cloud brightening. That seemed to be the driving interest of that experiment. I think it would be fairly clear what the driving interest of the experiment is. And I think intent or the driving motivation should actually matter in terms of where it ends up being falling in the risk categories and whether it comes into regulation or not. So that's one last thing about why this National Commission for the Study of Climate Change Choices. So the idea is that it's really scary to let geoengineering just go off as its own thing with its own scientific communities who are very focused on engineering. We've already heard in the first talk the necessity of integrating geoengineering interests, research, approaches with the larger climate change problem. The problem is climate change. How do we solve that problem? How can science help us solve that problem? Well, adaptation and mitigation are clearly just as or more important, And those have to, geoengineering has to be brought into that context. So I think this, you know, this body could be organized for the purpose of getting maybe certain kinds of examining geoengineering, but maybe it could foster the kinds of restructure some of the discussions around the other approaches to climate change, and even make proposals and be a leader in making proposals about how geoengineering research should be within a certain portfolio of research, an organized portfolio, to put more of a brain on what goes on, more of a brain on what goes on now, which seems to be random and not very well organized. So that's the proposal, and I'll leave it there.
All right, there's time for questions. Yes?
I'm a European. I'm very concerned about the underlying philosophy of your approach. You gave the example of mad cow disease. And in Europe, we see that as an American form of non-regulation. We would look at, for example, Monsanto. We would look at Union Carbide. And the question I've got for you is, you might be able to satisfy the regulators in the US, but would your approach, do you think, satisfy anyone in the rest of the world?
No, I think to say that our approach would satisfy everyone would be
anyone.
Completely anyone.
Anyone.
Yeah, well, yes, I think it would. It probably would satisfy the Brits. But I don't know. I mean, I think the point is that, I mean, I think, let me interpret your question more broadly, which is, how would this square up with this is an international problem. Other societies are dealing with this, and how would any kind of nationally determined process or set of recommendations square up or connect with those of other countries and any kind of international regime? And I think that's a challenge, a huge challenge. But I think that this commission could actually become a kind of node to do that kind of interchange and discussion that could actually try to promote convergence. Divergence is a huge problem with regulation writ large. But I think, you know, we also know that that science can help drive convergence in a lot of situations. So if there are joint research projects that could also build into agreement about risk assessment.
So a related question, and it gets to the efficacy of a governance mechanism like this commission, and then the practicality of actually getting it established.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just very briefly.
Okay. The issue is with efficacy or practicality of this kind of national commission in light of experience of the failures of mitigation, and so mitigation activity happening at lower levels of governance, as well as cross-national, international kinds of activities. How would they be governed by a national body? And I guess my response would be, for the most part, this stuff would be funded by governments. Maybe there'll be some rich private foundations that would kick in money. But that it's through governments that I think you would actually create assessment frameworks with political legitimacy. And once you had those in place, there would be pressure for non-government actors to comply. An example is clinical trials and also human subject research. That whole regime of regulation is attached to government funding. Initially, unless it's clinical trials, because that is subject to FDA approval, private actors could do research that don't comply with the common rule. But almost no research gets done that way in the private sector, because it's seen as just completely out of the norm. And it's expected that research will be conducted that way, especially if that's going to then be used in any kind of study or provide evidence for approvals, or regulatory or public approvals. So I think having a precedent of a government or a publicly accountable process will serve a lot of functions. It's not going to solve everything or govern everything. I think the point is that this is all a process, and that this is a way to start a process that's going to be robust over time, and which conceivably will accrete and aggregate its force over time. But to start a process is important. I think it has to be governmentally convened.
Okay, Mike McCracken, and then I'm going to exercise my prerogative.
It was only faster than a process that was already in place. So I think that the starting point has to be putting something in place. And then we can have a discussion, as we did then, about whether we need to really speed it up. But I think it's erroneous to say that it would take that long. I mean, I think it wouldn't take that long to get this up and going, especially to define, you know, what is not going to be regulated. If the administration were, yeah.
So I'll ask my question near the mic so you don't have to repeat it. So why would you base a governance regime on the purpose of the experiment rather than the risks posed by the experiment? I could imagine a regime where you'd say, well, anybody who wants to go out and do a scientific experiment that poses risks across a national boundary or to a global commons should be subject to this regime. Mm-hmm. And then the cost-benefit trade-off could be mm-hmm. done in that regulatory environment.
Yeah. So my point was not that risks aren't relevant. They're absolutely necessary, but I think that intent is relevant as well. Because one, you know, it matters to me if someone's in their garage within their protected privacy rights or whatever you think and starts making a bomb with the intent of setting it off in a public space. Now, I'm not saying that this is what geoengineers are doing, but it's relevant to us what is imagined, envisioned, intended when we start to build something. I think that's relevant to how people perceive risk. Now, how you'd actually, you know, translate that into different levels of oversight, I'm not sure. But I think that motivation, because it means being involved in a project that aims towards a potential deployment of a controversial technology, that's relevant.
Okay, thank you. So I'm just going to get the last word here, and that you can also consider the intent under a regulatory regime without it being the criteria for the application of that regime.
Yes,
right.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. So the next talk will be by Fei Chai, and it might just take me a minute to get it on the screen.
Do the keynote.
Keynote.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll just do this. Okay, let me just. Where is the button to make it big? I don't know how to make it big.
Thank you. I'm one of the 15 authors for this talk. I'm Chinese. That was my Chinese name up there. So it's really a group effort and a latest thinking representing this group. And so as you can tell, it's 15 institutions representing from six countries. So the ocean represents 70% of the surface, Earth's surface, and it carries out roughly half of the primary productivity, and on an annual mean basis translate into 50 gigatons carbon per year. And then roughly about 20% of that fixed carbon sink to the depths. We call it a biological pump. The rest of the 80% of the fixed carbon respired in the euphotic zone very rapidly. And 30% of the world ocean are characterized as a high nutrients, nitrate and phosphate, for example, and low chlorophyll. That means the area, the biological productivity, the phytoplankton, couldn't reach the maximum of their capacity to fix the carbon. So there's left unused nutrients in those areas. In part, that biological productivity in that 20% of the area, HNLC areas, are due to the iron limitation. One of the main iron sources to the surface ocean is through the dust deposition. As you can tell, the HNLC regions is far from the continent, so the dust deposition really couldn't reach that far. So the ocean also absorb or uptake the one-third of anthropogenic CO2, roughly about 2.5 gigaton of carbon. And last year, 2010, we anthropogenic CO2 reached the maximum records. It's about 9.1 gigaton of carbon released. So in the part that started about 20 years ago is the iron hypothesis limit the biological productivity in the Southern Ocean, the Equatorial Pacific, and North Pacific. It was really a hypothesis. It started with John Martin. They measured the iron and looked at a nitrate and phosphate and phytoplankton biomass, and he reached the conclusion it's the iron deficiency limits the biological productivity in those areas. You can tell the media reception 20 years ago picked up on this, but I don't think the word geoengineering existed back then. If even it did, it means quite different things. But also back then there were no blogs, there were no YouTubes. So the cartoons I think is a good reflection. This is really how you do the science, advanced science, you do the testing the hypothesis. In this case, the methods really matters. Back then, in the late 80s, 95% of the oceanographers didn't accept or agreed with John Martin's iron hypothesis. For the reason, because this way he did the test, or back then, is that they use these bottles, and then you create this artificial ecosystem after a few days. Because you stop the physics, you excluded all the grazers, so it's not a real, the ocean ecosystem. So that's why majority of the oceanographers didn't accept this hypothesis. So John Martin and his colleagues said, well, if we settle this debate, and we have to carry out the experiments, which is the open ocean experiments. And then the first two was done at the equator. 1993 and 1995. And then the rest of it is just a history. The 13 experiments carried out during the past two decades, the most recent one is a German and a Indian collaboration in the Southern Ocean. It was done 2 years ago, but it was subject to the environmental regulations, assessment, et cetera. It was very different than the previous, the iron experiment. Let me give you a few highlights to illustrate the point. This is done by the Canadian scientist, and then you can see they created about 10 kilometer by 10 kilometers patch. 3 weeks later, and that patch was visible from remote sensing, the satellite that detected. And then the week after that, and that patch just disappeared. But the point is, you see the scale. There was a nitro bloom all over the shelf near the Aleutian Islands. Those are recurring, the natural iron fertilization events going on all the time for many, many years. So that's the natural iron fertilization. That's one experiment. The second one was done by the Japanese scientist, and they, again, create this patch about 10 kilometer by 10 kilometer. 2 weeks later, you can tell the PCO2 in the fertilized area decreased by 100 ppm compared to the surrounding waters. If you calculate the CO2 fluxes in those areas, you can imagine how much the CO2 entered the ocean in those fertilized areas. So that's another experiment. The last experiment is the first two experiments, other experiments shown and documented the phytoplankton increase, the CO2 flux from the atmosphere into ocean increase. But the question is, what happened for that fixed CO2 in the surface and once they leave the euphotic zone? So the answer is not that straightforward and easy to capture that enhanced CO2. For example, you need a longer time and you need to follow the patch. You need a more sophisticated equipment to capture that fertilized the CO2, enhanced the CO2. So there's four experiments out of the 13 experiment done showed this enhancement of carbon export of the euphotic zone. 4 out of that 13. The other is due to the duration and then other limitations, and they didn't collect the data or they didn't see the data show this enhancement. So to summarize this 13 experiments, the science is clear. Once you add a iron, whether it's a nitro iron, the delivery from the dust or iron delivered by ship, et cetera, enhance the phytoplankton productivity, enhance the ocean uptake of CO2 from the atmosphere into the surface ocean. And then there's other similar events like volcanoes, the island effects also showed this enhanced productivity sequestration. Carbon. The question is not that clear is how much the carbon sequestered from the surface and can stay in the ocean, how long they will stay. What's the potential? Is it 100 million metric tons or 10 million metric tons? So we just don't have the experiment or the adequate model to show that. So what are the unintended or intended ecological consequences? So for example, those enhanced biological sinking particles will remineralize at a certain depths, which will decrease the oxygen, that's another for example, and whether they will stimulate a certain type of phytoplankton bloom that produce toxins and that will affect the ecosystem in a negative way. So those the issues are still not resolved. Most importantly, the scaling issue. All the previous experiments were done at a smaller scale, that 10 kilometer by 10 kilometer scale. How are you going to scale that scale to 100 kilometers or 1,000 kilometers, and in order to test the carbon sequestration efficiency and the capability. So those the issues are remain to be addressed. So there have been two workshops, and all happened at Woods Hole, and then all in the summer. One is the 2007. Some of the people in the audience attended. The second workshop, it was about a year ago in July. So after the first workshop, from the scientific point of view, we listed a set of questions and the priorities we need to carry out the next generation ocean iron fertilization experiments for the reason that the previous experiment were not designed to address this carbon sequestration related issues. So those the list, and I'm a modeler, so from the modeling point of view, we need to have the experiment, we need to have the data to improve and test your model. You cannot just use the global model and then which have not calibrated or tested with this type of research to answer those questions. So the also the issue is who will support this type of research. And then as you previous the speakers mentioned, this lack of the directions and the federal support on this type of research is really the problem. So last July, we had a meeting, and there's a smaller scale. It's about 20 of scientists representing a dozen or so institutions. And we decided there's a need to form a consortium or a group that we all motivated to address those uncertainties and then the question related to the large-scale iron fertilization experiments. And we outlined the mission statement and et cetera. So it's really the in situ iron studies that include the natural iron fertilization experiment, such as you studied the downstream island effect or volcanoes, et cetera. But you have to really wait for the volcano to erupt to capture that, or you have to go to the remote island. But so to answer that question, we have the mission statement. So far, 13 institutions signed up on this a consortium. So we have a three objectives, and really is to carry out a experiment. It's a, we call the next generation iron fertilization experiment at a reasonable larger scale and a longer duration. And we also want to address the potential, the consequences, intended and unintended consequences. And most importantly, we need to calibrate the models to scale this up, to do the estimate, and for some certainty, and et cetera. So this is the near-term the activities. We're looking for the fundings, and then also it has to be have a certain guidance, and such as we work with the London Convention and London Protocols, that is the international organization have been following with this iron fertilization activities, and some of us from the scientific community work really hard to put that three words in that statement. The legitimate scientific research should be carried forward. And so they adopted this assessment framework just about a year ago. So from the scientific research point of view, we have something to follow. And from this London Protocol and London Convention. So there is a summary of you can get, it's not just the iron, the other nutrients and artificial upwelling, et cetera. So we're hoping to use the ICES as the platform to carry out the next generation open ocean iron fertilization experiments. Thank you.
Questions? Yes?
Based on. So how can we
poorly constrained is the ocean carbon budget. If you look at where we are with observational understanding of understanding the carbon cycle across in the ocean, not just the shallow waters, and all of these questions, one can conclude we're one to two decades away from having a sufficient understanding of that to establish a baseline. So how can we do that? How can we proceed with open ocean experiments when we haven't constrained the tree perturbation data?
All right. The chairman asked me to repeat the question. The question is, how do we establish the baseline and today before we can carry out the iron fertilization experiment? Well, we need more observational research and the targeted areas, and that's, I think, to start. And I don't think that type of research should be labeled as a geoengineering because we're not doing anything to start with. But you have to start with a certain controlled areas, the regions, except the water moves around. That created a lot of difficulties to do this type. But on the other hand, I think we have some bases for certain regions. We know what is the productivity, what is the capability of the ocean sequestrated carbon and sink to the depths. I think we do have certain areas with that knowledge. And the issue is you need to carry out this. But again, the long-term, the ecological consequences, that's difficult to address. You need to follow that patch of water and et cetera. It's all need more coordination and from the different communities and from the different agencies.
The reason why I poke at it is with some other geoengineering analogs on tests, like stratospheric, like volcanoes for stratospheric air fault convection, or ship tracks for the marine layer about albedo monitoring, you can't get there with in situ measurements alone. You need the remote sensing because of the scales we're talking about the cross boundary issues, but how from the world in comparison, and given the depth of the ocean, right? And the inability to remote sense, and the sparse network.
Yeah, well, I think the latest activity under the ICES consortium or the goals is the natural iron fertilization with the island effect. The downstream of islands, you pick up the sediment and the iron, you can study that. But unfortunately, this is in a remote region, you need a lot of money and the resources to do this. So they just came back and the French and the others just came back and finished one experiment in the Southern Ocean. I think we need this type of coordination and research, but I agree with you. And so.
So I'm sorry, but we've gone from being well ahead of schedule to behind schedule, so we're just gonna have to move on. So
right.
Sorry about my time management here. So next talk is Jacob Hakmisra, on ethics as an integral component of geoengineering analysis.
So thanks, everyone. I'm going to report on some work that I've done with my team here at Penn State. I'm a postdoc, and Nancy and Klaus Keller are my postdoctoral advisors. Everyone else is a member of the team. And we're just going to talk about how geoengineering poses some fundamental challenges to ethics that are actually embedded in the science research as it's ongoing. And so we're going to need to ask some ethical questions during the course of geoengineering research. And so sort of as a motivation, this is sort of a conceptual cartoon version of maybe a standard picture. This is not how everyone looks at research. But geoengineering is an interdisciplinary question, but oftentimes we focus on, okay, first we need to hit the middle of this target, focus on the geosciences. Once we understand the climate responses really well, we understand the physics behind this, then we move on to impacts and we say, okay, how does what we know about the climate impact regions and impact governments, and then that leads us to then determine what sort of policy is relevant for the choices we want, and then finally we say, okay, which of these choices are ethical and how do we go about bringing these causes into being in an ethical way. We're going to argue that this, starting from the middle of the bullseye and working your way out, it sort of misses important connections between all of these different rings. I mean, the policy certainly is going to impact your science, and ethics is you know, in some ways an overarching component that really relates to all of these issues. And so what I'm going to talk about is moving from a picture like this into something that's maybe a little bit more integrated. And so we heard a little bit about an analogy from biology, from genetic engineering. So this is a slightly different analogy that we're going to take from the Human Genome Research Project, which is another example of a very interdisciplinary research project that has very high potential for benefits for medicine, but also carries a number of risks and potential risks for how you use or misuse this information. And so this is just a quote I pulled here where the planners of the Human Genome Project recognize that the information that you gain from mapping and sequencing the human genome is very profound, have implications for individuals, families, and societies. And while these may have benefits, there's also a number of complex ethical, legal, and social issues. And so what they did is they created this ethical, legal, and social implications research program, which is an integral part of the Human Genome Project. And so this provides a way for important questions that come up during research to be addressed in terms of their ethical, legal, and social implications. I mean, this is very important for the Human Genome Project because we're interested in making timely progress between genetic research and, you know, progress in treating diseases and medical conditions. The analogy to climate research is similar, and especially with geoengineering, we want to move on climate with some sense of urgency. And so while we do want to do the best research we can, it's also important that we are thinking about the ethics in tandem with the science, especially if we want to use some sort of combination of mitigation, adaptation, and geoengineering to address climate change. So just solar, we're mostly talking about solar radiation management through aerosol injection, although this does apply to ocean fertilization and some other geoengineering techniques. But you know, some of the issues that come up with SRM, on the top I've got more of the geophysical issues where you can alter precipitation patterns, which leads to different regional responses. So a particular geoengineering strategy may not create an equal number of winners or losers, or you may not make an equal number of people happy, at least. You do have continued ocean acidification with SRM through aerosol deployment. You have ozone depletion. So these are some challenges that we've seen from doing the geophysics. But all of these, you can see, there's ethical issues involved in how do you deal with harms to people, both the distribution of people among different regions, the distribution of people among regions of the world, among wealth, and then future people as well. What do we have obligations to them? Do we have any obligations to leave the world in a certain state for the descendants of humans? So these are ethical issues that once we realize what the physical challenges are in geoengineering, then it becomes important to address these ethical questions. There's also some other risks involved. There's the risk of unilateral deployment. This is a very cheap technology, and many players around the world could choose to unilaterally deploy an SRM strategy, particular, for example, if you're a coastal region, a low-lying island state, you may have a vested interest and a different interest in geoengineering strategy than maybe a continental agrarian state that has some interest, but there are different interests at play. So this is a risk, and even if global consensus is not in favor of deploying SRM right now, you still have the risk that some player or some group of players might. There's the risk of unintentional discontinuance, which is that SRM is a strong temporal commitment, that once we engage in it, you have to continue this for hundreds or thousands of years. And disrupting this, if you know, World War III or for whatever other reason, disrupting this continual SRM emission would actually have a greater amount of warming that's produced in the long term than if we had not embarked on SRM at all. So these are some important things that need to be addressed before deployment, but as research is going on. And then I didn't put anything about technology here, about the nozzles and hoses and things that you need to deploy SRM, but that's actually important as well, because if you're going to design a gun or you're going to design a bomb, but you're never going to fire it off, I mean, perhaps that is useful. I mean, perhaps, you know, it is useful in a detrimental sense to have weapons on hand. That's one of the reasons we have a military, to prevent aggression. But if we do design nozzles and we design the infrastructure to do SRM, the question at least needs to be raised. You know, are we building this only to not use it, or is the fact that we're building it going to mean there's a higher likelihood that we will actually deploy it? So these are just issues that are related. So here's maybe a better conceptual map compared to my bullseye of the interdisciplinary nature of geoengineering research. So there's the scientific questions, which asks questions like, is it feasible, and what are the impacts on climate, and can we project some of those, which then informs some economic questions. What are the risks? What are the regrets? What are the uncertainties in the system? You know, is it pass a cost-benefit test? In which, you know, ties into ethical questions. Are we making procedural ethical decisions? Are we arriving at a useful state? Are we arriving at a better state through an ethical process? Are we considering the distribution of effects in time and in space and across different generations? And then this, you know, informs policy decisions. Can we come to an agreement on this? Do we know what technology do we use? Can we implement it? And then, you know, these all feed back into one another. So, I mean, a simple picture, but it emphasizes the cycle of connections rather than an inward to outward approach like I showed on the bullseye. So one thing that we did is we looked at the different types of SRM research that are going on now and that are being proposed, and we delineated into three different categories. And this is based on impacts and based on types of ethical questions that these types of research raise. And so category one, we include theoretical analyses like computer modeling, GCM work, analyses of natural events, volcanic eruption analyses, looking at global precip over long periods of time, temperature reconstructions, laboratory testing of relevant technology, so that would include nozzle development in the lab, testing it in closed conditions. Everything in this category one, it does open the Pandora's box about now we know how to do this technology, but arguably we already know the cat's out of the bag. We know how to do geoengineering. We at least know that it's possible. There's nothing to hide there. So, but category one, none of these research projects impact the global environment in a direct way. These are all contained. They're either theoretical or they're done within a closed system. If we move to the category two now we're calling this SRM pre-deployment for testing. This is where there's actually some field test, even though it's not necessarily a global test to actually get a global cooling signal. This would be where you're actually testing the nozzles in the field, or you're trying to measure some local region to see if you get some amount of cooling. Or, you know, this could even include, you know, testing something like ocean fertilization. Any sort of pre-deployment, which is not actually for cooling the global climate, but it's to test your technology and test your understanding of the physics to see how robust it is. Now, that's a problem because we put this in a different category, even though some people might say this is the same as analyzing a volcanic eruption. The volcano's already erupted in the case of category one. That was through no intention of our own, you know, did this volcano go off, so it's a natural experiment. Category two, we have now decided we are going to emit some particulate matter into the atmosphere and see what its effects are. So you're going to have some effect on a region, and so this is arguably a different category of research. And then finally, in category three, this is full deployment for geoengineering, where the goal is to get some sort of global cooling signature. So one of the reasons that we emphasize the difference between this category two, you know, pre-deployment, and then category three, full deployment, is partial deployment doesn't necessarily tell you how close you are to a climate threshold. And so we've got a sort of a cartoon diagram where we've got a climate state here and then a forcing times a sensitivity. And there's two trajectories. There's a red trajectory here, and there's a blue trajectory. And if you think of this ball as the climate state today, a small perturbation, you know, such as from a local regional geoengineering experiment, a small perturbation does not necessarily tell you if you're on the red curve or on the blue curve. And you may actually overinterpret local experiments, or you may just not be able to interpret local experiments because they don't tell you how the climate system, the full global climate system, would respond to that type of forcing. So the analogy between the regional, you know, testing for pre-deployment, it may tell you some things about if this technology works, can your nozzle spray efficiently, but in terms of how does the climate respond, you may find that pre-deployment shows you one response, whereas full deployment puts you on this blue trajectory and you end up, say, you know, maybe this is melting Greenland or you know, the shutdown of the oceanic circulation or something like that. So it's important to think about the distinctions and what can we really learn from these regional experiments and how does that really help us learn about what a global geoengineering deployment might look like. So a few critical questions that we raise, and then there's others, and this paper I should mention we've submitted to Ethics, Policy, and Environment, so you'll hopefully be able to read it soon. But, you know, can geoengineering be tested? I mean, to what extent can we test these things? And there are, you know, computer-based models and analyses of volcanoes, but how well can we test the degree to which full deployment would be adequate and what responses we need to think about that? How well can we know this, or are we really not going to know at least some important factors until we've actually deployed? Political risks, I mean, certainly different players are going to have different motivations for wanting to deploy SRM. How do we value different climate trajectories? I mean, SRM is not there's not one particular strategy or one particular target for SRM. There are different climate trajectories, you know, without SRM, and then once we introduce SRM into the equation, we can now end up with several different possible climate states. So, you know, the question of value becomes important. How fast do we learn? I mean, this is an important thing, especially because geoengineering requires some degree of commitment over long time scales. So it's important to be able to learn as we go. And then, you know, how do we control this? And if we do decide that we need to embark on this long-term commitment, then how do we make sure that we don't get the bounce back from abrupt cessation? So just to conclude, these ethical issues, I hope I've at least convinced you somewhat that there are ethics that are important within geoengineering research and maybe beyond very basic climate modeling research. There's really embedded ethics along the way at pretty much every stage. So, you know, we hope that ethical analysis will help lay the foundation for future research agendas into geoengineering, and we propose that geoengineering research would benefit from the creation of an ethical, legal, and social implications program. Thank you.
Question over here? Brief questions, please. Brief questions, please.
Oh, that's absolutely right. Yeah, just by putting it on the table, people say, oh, we have this geoengineering technology available. It may be less important to mitigate because this technology will do just fine. That's a big question, yes. Yeah, that's in this paper, too. I just didn't put it as a bullet point, but absolutely. No, so I think you're... Well, no, I fundamentally agree with you, and if I go back to the analogy I made with the Human Genome Project, That's not to say that the creation of an ethical, legal, social implications program said we should not sequence the human genome, but this is saying there are important risks and important questions that are going to be raised by doing this research, so if we're going to embark on it, let's ask the ethical and social questions as we do it and not wait until the very end when it might be too late to be relevant. So I think we should study geoengineering. I'm not going to say whether or not we should deploy it, but I think if we're asking that question, we need to be asking the parallel ethical questions, you know, at the same time.
Okay, since it's going to come out of my time if he answers another question, we're going to move on.
Okay.
So let me reset this here. So I'm going to shorten my talk a little bit so we can get out and hopefully have a drink. So, so my title here is we don't need a geoengineering research program, and I don't, you know, it's kind of a teaser because I think we need geoengineering research, and the question is how should that research best be structured? And so I'd like to emphasize two things. One is the letter A, and the other is the word geoengineering. I guess part of, I have a few different concerns. So one is, you know, we could think of having a research program into things that are roughly spherical. And, you know, we'd research planets and soap bubbles and watermelons and things like that. And you could design that, but, you know, is that a sensible way of structuring a research program? The other thing is that sort of spherical things, research program really encompass the full domain of things you want to consider. So I think, and this was alluded actually in David Vinnikoff's discussion of that it doesn't make sense to just do the governance of geoengineering, but you want to think about it more broadly. And you know, some of you have seen this circle before, but you know, the way I think of carbon dioxide removal and sunlight reflection or solar radiation management methods is that it's part of a suite of various efforts to reduce risks associated with climate change. And I won't go through this in great detail, but basically, you know, their conservation and efficiency try to break the link between the consumption of energy and the provision of improved well-being. And then the low-carbon energy technologies try to break the link between CO2 emissions and energy consumption. The carbon dioxide removal approaches, like Fei Chai spoke about, try to break this link between CO2 emissions and CO2 accumulation in the atmosphere. The sunlight reflection methods, or solar radiation management, tries to break the link between CO2 in the atmosphere and the amount of climate change. And then adaptation tries to break this link between the amount of climate change and the impacts on humans and ecosystems. And I guess I see little reason to separate out this sector of this circle. And you know, if you think it's going to be unfunded, you might think of it as a sort of scientific ghetto. If you think it will attract all the funds, you might think of it as a scientific gated community. But in either case, I see no reason to isolate you know, these methods and approaches of reducing risks associated with our consumption of material goods away from other climate-related research efforts. And so I think at some level I would like to see, you know, if we're talking about national commissions or national advisory panels, a panel that would consider this full spectrum of approaches and think, you know, what is the rational allocation of resources both on the R&D side and on the deployment side to minimize the risks posed by climate change. So I guess from that perspective, a geoengineering research program is too small, that we need a research program that really encompasses the full spectrum of risk reduction approaches. But from another perspective, a geoengineering research program is too large. That we need a variety of programs aimed at reducing climate risk. And so if we, let me just pop past that one again. If we go to, you know, carbon dioxide removal methods, which is a bunch illustrated here, like this ocean fertilization and so on, you know, there are a whole bunch of disparate kinds of
research activities here. So, I mean, this is intended to represent biomass, you know, so basically you grow biomass and then you burn that biomass in a power plant with carbon capture and storage. That, you know, it seems to me naturally related to existing biomass energy projects, existing carbon capture and storage research programs, and there's no reason that I can see to closely link that or house that in a research program aimed at studying the efficacy of ocean fertilization. There's various ideas on how to accelerate chemical weathering by making various soil amendments. That could be looked at in the context of other programs that look at soil properties and the way that soil, properties affect geochemical fluxes. You could imagine biochar, putting that in soils and understanding its effect in the soils is not that too distant from understanding effects of no-till agriculture, So I guess there's two things I'm trying to say here, that I don't see many of these things are very disparate and don't necessarily benefit from being lumped together as a part of a single research program, and some of them especially, and I think two that pop out here are this biomass with carbon capture and storage or the industrial CO2 removal from air. That there's already existing research programs that are looking at carbon capture from power plant flue stacks, and those people have expertise in removal of carbon dioxide from gases, and that those research programs could be expanded to encompass a broader domain, but we don't necessarily need to create new bureaucracies and new research programs. That I think that there's benefit to expanding scope of existing activities. And I think there's another piece, which I can say it here. So here's a little solar radiation management cartoon. I think that most of the research into sunlight reflection or solar radiation management methods can be integrated into existing climate science research programs. And as we heard Rob Wood talk about, that really he would like to do the same sorts of experiments to understand the effects of aerosols on clouds, and that there's an advantage to expanding the scope of existing cloud research efforts into considering intentionally introduced aerosols rather than having a separate cloud modification research program. And I think there's a number of reasons. I mean we'll take Alan Robach for an example, who's done a lot of work on volcanic eruptions and the effects of volcanic eruptions on climate, and then he expanded his research program to consider intentionally introduced aerosols. And one of the advantages of having regular climate scientists looking at these other options is that there's less of a vested interest in finding out that this is a valuable thing that we need to develop further. There's a tendency of bureaucracies that once you create a bureaucracy, the bureaucracy wants to grow and keep itself going. And so some people propose, though, that we should make centers, that we'd have a new sort of institution that would be focused on exploring each of these options. And I think once you create an institution, within the institution there'll be a dynamic that will say, well, look, information that suggests that this isn't such a good idea, well, let's kind of sweep that under the rug, and the stuff that says that it is a good idea, let's try to promote that because we want to keep money coming in the door. And I mean, I've worked in institutions where keeping money coming in the door was an imperative. And so I think that there's a real advantage to, rather than creating new research programs, to expanding the scope of existing research programs so that scientists who are engaged in normal climate science are working on geoengineering approaches part-time rather than having their whole livelihood depending on doing geoengineering research. And the other side of it has to do with engineering of actual deployment systems, because I do think when you want to, as opposed to doing what the way I look at the scientific research, mostly what's needed at this point is I would characterize it as environmental science. But there's another piece of it that is engineering development of deployment systems. And there was a recent study by, I think it was Aurora Flight Research, looking at what it would take to put an aerosol layer in the stratosphere. And basically, you could fly a bunch of planes around for several billion dollars, and it doesn't look that hard. When President Kennedy said we'll go to the moon, within a decade, we were at the moon. And none of this stuff seems as challenging as going to the moon. And so I think that the real developing dedicated engineering programs to develop deployment systems can wait until there's actually a decision that we need to deploy these things, or at least that we need to seriously consider deploying these things. I will make certain exceptions here, that I do think that feasibility studies are useful. So is it possible to make particles that are controllable in time so that they can be on in one season and off in another season? If we knew whether that was feasible, then that would drive climate studies to see what the climate effects of temporal modulation would be. Also, if Alan Gaddy and Rob Wood want to do their experiment, you will need some nozzles to deploy this stuff. So, I'm not saying that no engineering development, but I wouldn't start having big organizations to start doing deployment systems. And so, really, I'm just going to wind up there, basically, to say that that I think that we don't need a program that sort of isolates these approaches towards risk reduction from the broader spectrum of approaches aimed at solving the climate carbon problem, that on both the carbon dioxide removal and this sunlight reflection or solar radiation management sides, that there's a disparate collection of things that are in general best explored by expanding existing programs and funding a broader domain so that scientists like Fei Chai, who are interested in marine biogeochemical cycles, can do manipulative experiments, so Alan Gaddy and Rob Wood can do manipulative experiments, and that we need this broadening of research programs. I guess what I'm saying is that we need to bring what's called geoengineering research into the mainstream and have it be an ordinary part of our climate related science and not wall it off as a separate activity. Thank you.
Oh, questions?
Any questions?
But just briefly, because you all want to go out.
Okay. Very briefly.
Yeah.
Maybe commercialization is a separate part.
Okay, without going through that whole thing, and then we'll try to make this question answer brief, that the question about that the climate science doesn't strategize and do any kind of optimal allocation of resources on a mission-based approach. And I think I started off by saying that we do need a high-level advisory board or commission that would look across this entire spectrum of approaches and prioritize both research and development efforts. And so I recognize that need, and I would say that broader program should do that. Mike?
Go on and not prepare to see if there are options for the
Well, I know John Nissen's here. You know, he was been talking about the threats to the Arctic ice and thinks we need to sort of deploy things today or yesterday. And so, you know, rather than commenting on that directly, if that's the case, then there should be a discussion. And I think that it would be better for society first to come to a decision that we need to develop these systems, and then we set about developing them. And you know, like, so this recent experiment that was in India, I forget what it's called, SPICE or something, you know, that proposed experiment. Anyway, you know, I just think that if people get out and start doing sort of experiments or that are aimed at developing deployment systems, that the potential for backlash and all kinds of controversy is much greater. And there, at this point, I think we're in a phase where we should be focusing on environmental science, have the discussion about whether we need to be developing deployment systems, but hold off on really developing the deployment systems until there's some kind of consensus that we need to do it. I think it's, we're 6 minutes after time, and so I think we better close here. So I would thank myself and all the other speakers and Eli for putting this together. So thank you very much.